Well, good morning. Oh, come on, we can do better than that. Good morning. Awesome, awesome. We're so glad you joined us for worship this morning here at Epworth. If you're watching us on Channel 6 or on YouTube or on Facebook Live, we'd like to welcome you as well today. You might notice there's something a little bit different up here today. Scott's not here. Got texted this morning. Scott's under the weather this morning, so I'll be filling in this morning here for everything, so bear with me, and a lot of grace. A couple of announcements to pass along to you. The Wednesday night Bible study will still be taking place, but the women's Bible study for this coming Tuesday has been canceled. It will resume on the 9th, so the Elijah study going on up at the TV studio on Tuesday nights will not take place this week, but we'll start again next week for that. So want to just pass that along to you. Also, glad the weather's behind us a little bit. Glad we're seeing some folks that we haven't seen in a while. So amen. Amen to that. God is good all the time, right? Amen. So we're seeing, the shots are being distributed. We had another shot clinic on Friday. I can't remember how many people we put through. Kyle was one, which anyway, we'll leave it at that. But I think we have them scheduled every Friday through April, if I'm not mistaken. How much? 800 last Friday. So, and I think most of them are going to be that way from now on. As you can tell, on Fridays, our parking lot is full. And I pray that our Sunday mornings will get back to that as well. But, you know, it's just a blessing that we can, as a church, congregation, offer our facilities for something like this. And I think that is very, very awesome that we've gone out and done that. But as we begin worship this morning, let's just take the time to just kind of center up a little bit and know that we're here to focus on God and our relationship with Jesus Christ. As we begin our worship service this morning, let us go to our call to worship this morning. Let's please rise. Let us turn our minds from human things. Let us set our minds on divine things. We will deny ourselves and take up our cross.
Our faith in Jesus saves us.
We will lose all that we may gain all.
Our faith in Jesus saves us.
Good morning, everyone. We will be starting off this morning with holy water.
Down the stairs, the road.
Amen. You may be seated.
The cross came to represent all of Christianity. But why? Why not the fish? It's a pretty good Christian symbol, right? I mean, sure, Jesus was crucified upon the cross, but when and why did it become synonymous with all of Christianity? I mean, because it looked good on the top of a steeple or hanging from the end of a necklace? I mean, it's true, it does look better than a, you know, little minnow or trout hanging from a necklace. Well, we are about to find out all about the cross on this episode of Chuck Knows Church. Is the most widely accepted reminder of Jesus' victory over death, believing that through his death and resurrection, there is life eternal. But the cross, as a symbol of Christianity, did not happen immediately after Easter. Now, during the first 2 centuries of Christianity, the cross was rarely seen as a symbol or an icon. Now, some say it depicted such a painful, gruesome public execution that Christians were reluctant to use it. Understandable. Now, some historians point out that there is no cross in Christian art until the 5th century, and Jesus was not depicted upon that cross until hundreds of years after that. Now, why would that be? Well, not surprisingly, there are several different historical opinions. That's right. Disagreement amongst members of the church. I do declare I am aghast. Ooh. Now, be that as it... Sorry. Be that as it may, today, the cross is seen everywhere as a symbol of Christianity. Now, Roman Catholics often show Jesus actually on the cross, known as the crucifix. Now, this is to emphasize Jesus as most important, rather than, you know, the cross by itself. Then there are the Protestant traditions that prefer the cross without Jesus, intentionally focusing on Jesus' resurrection after the execution on the cross. Now, whichever way you feel comfortable displaying the cross, in church or in your home or simply on a little dangling necklace, know that it unites Christians everywhere with the message of God's act of love. Now, to learn more, you can ask your pastor. Tell him Chuck sent you. Huh, what about salmon? Salmon necklace, right? Not that it... Be swimming upstream, wouldn't you? It might be uncomfortable. Yeah, no salmon.
Next part of our worship service is about going to God. We all have concerns, we all have prayers. And there are sometimes we just need to take time just to thank God for Him being with us. And I think it's important for us to make sure we set that time apart in prayer this morning. Now, you'll find our prayer list, if you picked up a bulletin this morning, on the back. Also, if you're watching us online, Channel 6, or on YouTube, on Facebook Live, you can go to epworth.info and go to the prayers. You can also find our complete prayer list there. As this morning, let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father God, we come to you this morning, Lord, as a gathered people. Lord, just to come together, fellowship with one another, and Lord, just to come and praise you this morning. Lord, that brings us joy in our life. And Lord, we know that there is some of us that are not with us because of that. Father, we just ask that you be with each one of them today, that may be watching online or maybe watching on Channel 6, Lord. Father, that's maybe not here physically with us, Lord, but they're with us as a whole. And Lord, we give thanks for that. And we give thanks to you. Lord, as we go through this season of Lent, Lord, this is a time that we normally just reflect back and we begin that preparation, that waiting time, until we know that you have died and was raised again on that glorious Easter morning. Father, you've told us the stories many times through your book and your word. Lord, help us to be people that are working towards being Easter people. Lord, we lift up those that are sick. We lift up our pastor, Scott, who's homesick this morning, Lord. Lord, we give thanks for him. But Lord, we also ask that you put your healing touch upon Scott so he can come back with us. Father, we know that there are those out there that are hurting in one way or another, Lord. This pandemic has touched things in each one of us, Lord, that's kind of brought us down. Lord, help us return our vision, our sight, not to those troubles, but to you. Lord, you made this earth, and you took delight in what you created. Father, we come to you this morning asking you, Lord, to be with us each and every day, alongside us as a trusted friend, as a father, as a teacher. Lord, help us to get on the straight and narrow towards having our eyes and our sight always set on you. Father, we come here this morning to praise you, to give thanks to you, to lift up our burdens to you, Lord. Lord, we know when we lift up our burdens to you, Lord, that you take them and you take them away from us so that we can live freely. And it's because of your grace that we can. Lord, we give thanks to you. And Lord, now we take time in the silence of our own hearts, Lord, to lift our personal prayers to you this morning. And now we pray the prayer Jesus taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, and thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us of our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. One thing I did want to bring up, and we found out word this morning that Tim Ketchum, the son-in-law of Joanne Brummel, passed away last night. So keep them in your prayers and the family in your prayers this morning as we continue on in our worship service. May God's grace be with them. Our scripture this morning comes from Mark 8. Verses 31 through 38, as we hear God's word for us this morning. Then he began to teach them that the Son of Man must undergo great suffering and be rejected by the elders, the chief priests, and the scribes, and be killed, and after 3 days rise again. He said all this quite openly. Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him. And by turning and looking at his disciples, he rebuked Peter and said, "Get behind me, Satan, for you are setting your mind not on divine things, but on human things." He called the crowd with his disciples and said to them, If any want to become my followers, let them deny themselves and take up their cross and follow me. For those who want to save their life will lose it, and those who lose their life for my sake and for the sake of the gospel will save it. For what will it profit them to gain the whole world and forfeit their life? Indeed, what can they give in return for their life? Those who are ashamed of me and of my words in this adulterous and sinful generation, of them the Son of Man will also be ashamed when he comes in the glory of his Father with the holy angels. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. So this morning, just a little history lesson for you, recent history. You know, part of the associate's job is to be prepared when the senior pastor is not here. Angie, shake your head yes. As Scott texted me at 5:45 this morning, and he was sick, it's always the associate pastor's job to be ready to sit, to step right in. So after I got that text this morning at 6 o'clock, I started writing a sermon. Now, most of you would say, well, you've been a pastor for a while. Don't you have a canned sermon you can bring out? I probably could have. But when Scott, what you may or may not know, you may be part of this group, but Scott sends out his sermon title and scripture about Thursday of the week. And I always try to sit there and think about, and Scott's probably watching at home, where's he going with this? I try to play a game a little bit in my own mind. Okay, where's he going? What's he going to say about this? Scott, if you're watching, I may be totally off. But that's okay. Of course, you know, I like to start with something a little bit funny to start off my sermons. And it just so happens this joke goes with the sermon. But there were three men that were traveling on a ship. And they were accosted by the devil. And the devil proposes that if each man drops something into the sea and he cannot find it, Satan will be that man's slave. But if the devil does find it, he's going to eat the man up, devour him. Well, the first man thinks he's going to be very, very smart. He takes a small diamond and he drops it in the sea. Satan finds it. Eats him up. Second man thinks, okay, got to be smarter than that. So he takes his expensive watch off, drops it in the sea. Just like that, Satan finds it, devours him up. The third man, though, takes a little different approach. He takes a bottle, fills it with water, pours it into the sea, yelling, I'm not an idiot. Go find it. Pray for me while I pray for us this morning. Father God, let the words of my mouth, the meditation of all our hearts, Lord, be pleasing unto you this morning. Amen. This morning I want to spend a little bit of time talking about what it means to live a life in Christ. Now I have to be honest this morning, and I think you'll find that it's true as well. It's hard these days, very, very hard to devote yourself to a life with Christ completely. I find it hard for me, and I fail miserably a lot. It gets harder these days. So much things going on, the negativity that's going on in the world, the pandemic, political situations, all those things tend to have a block for us. And we kind of get drawn and sucked in to all that. We get all worried about it. We get all tense about it. It's a task to be a Christian these days, isn't it? Can I hear an amen on that? All right. Well, you know, Peter himself had problems with that. The scripture this morning that I read from Mark 8, we're going to go back to that. We're going to talk about some of the issues he was having as well as Jesus foretells his death and resurrection. And back in verse 31, He says, then he began to teach them that the Son of Man must undergo great suffering and be rejected by the elders, the chief priests, the scribes, and he would also be killed, and after 3 days rise again. And he said all this quite openly. But Peter's a man. He took Jesus aside, and he began to rebuke him a little bit. But then Jesus turns and looks at his disciples, and he says, "Get behind me, Satan. Get behind me." He says, "You're setting your mind not on divine things, but on human things." So my question this morning is, how's your vision? Do we have our minds set on the here and the now? Or are we taking our time to look to the divine and the heavenly things? It's important to us to do that, to look beyond the earthly things up to the divine and the heavenly things. I want to point out a couple things that we too have the same issues that Peter had that day. Peter only sees what's going on around him. I mean, think about Peter being in his footsteps. He doesn't want anything to change. He's got Jesus with him. Jesus is going around, he's teaching. He's healing. A lot of things taking place. Peter loves being a part of that. We would all love to be part of that, wouldn't we? Amen. Yeah, we would have. But now, he begins to talk about rejection. Jesus does. He begins to talk about his own death. Peter doesn't like it. You're crushing my dream. You're changing everything. We were supposed to have this great plan to go out and save all these folks and to get them all to follow in the way. Peter was probably feeling a little bit under the weather, you could say. I mean, think about it. Peter along was watching Jesus save people. Heal people. People were coming from all over just to listen and to be healed by Jesus. You go a little bit earlier in the Mark chapter, in the Mark, where he had the feeding of the 4,000. People were coming everywhere to see Jesus and to hear the good news. How in the world can we now be talking about death and rejection? The fans were flocking to the concert. But the concert was about to be over. How could Jesus be talking about rejection and death? You see, Jesus was talking about the great change that was about to happen. Because it was only going to go from what it was, really, really good, to bad. Now, if you would be like Paul Harvey, the rest of the story is it gets really good after that. But think about our own situation right now, our reality here. Things around the world, things in our country, even here in Chickasha and in our church. We were going pretty good before last year, weren't we? Things were great. Life was happening. How we lived, how we interacted, how we went about our days, all became affected because of a virus. Think about our church. Think about the people who were here and then were gone. Some of you were part of them. Thank God for our online and our television ministry, huh? Amen for that. You had the foresight to think about that many years ago. Many years ago. We were able to survive. But many stopped worshiping completely. Think about it for a second. Those of you who are here, look around the room. Now, I'm seeing some faces I haven't seen in a while, which is filling my heart full of joy. But who are we still missing? Who are we still missing? No fault in that. I want everybody to stay healthy and stay safe as much as anybody else. And I am glad to see those who are here. We've had to change. Peter's life changed at that time. Our life has changed. I believe now we're getting to the point of getting better. Do I ever really think we're going to get back to the point we were before all this happened? Probably not. I like to hope, but I think the masks that we're wearing will be a part of our everyday life for a while. I don't know how long, but I think they're going to be part of our life for a while. Think about the people again who aren't here. Those who might be watching at home, think about those who you miss seeing, because we love coming here on Sunday morning and fellowshipping, don't we? Seeing each other. It brings joy to our hearts, and we haven't been able to do that for a while. I think we're getting to the point where we're going to get closer to re-engaging with everybody, and our family becomes whole again at some point. I think we're getting there. I have to have the faith that we're going to get there. Say a prayer for those who aren't with us. If you're at home, say a prayer for those who might be here. It's difficult for us to change our mindset. We're creatures of habit, aren't we? We are programmed. We program ourselves in our own routines, in our own days. We have a certain way we like to do things, right? COVID changed all that and created what I call a new bubble, our COVID bubble. It got us out of the bubble we were in and put us into a new bubble with masks and isolation. It was difficult for me. It was difficult for me. I am somewhat of a social person, and it was difficult for me to sit at the house and work when I got sent home. It was difficult. But I think as this pandemic begins to wind down, as more people get the vaccines, as we start seeing the numbers of COVID cases come down, we're going to see a new bubble form. I don't think it's going to be the same bubble as what we had before. I'd like to think it would be close. But it all has to do with what we're used to. You know, I talked about those who have quit worshiping altogether. It's going to be difficult, and it's going to take all of us to get people back in the churches and back in their relationship with Christ. It's not going to take Scott. It's not going to take me. It's not going to take the leaders of this church. It's going to take everybody, each one of us. So I'm asking the question again. How's your vision? Are you set on the earthly things? Are you set on the divine things? As Jesus went on after rebuking Peter and talking to the disciples, He called the crowd of disciples, and beginning in verse 34 here, he talks about taking that first step. He called the crowd with his disciples and said to them, if anyone want to become my followers, then let them deny themselves and take up their cross and follow me. For those who want to save their life will lose it, and those who will lose their life for my sake and for the sake of the gospel will save it. For what will it profit them to gain the whole world and forfeit their life? Indeed, what can they give in return for their life? Those who are ashamed of me and of my words in this adulterous and sinful generation, of them the Son of Man will also be ashamed when he comes in the glory of his Father and with the holy angels. Very powerful and right to the point words Jesus spoke to the disciples. I would call it a mild chewing out for thinking of things of that nature. But sometimes it takes a good slap in the face to get woken up a little bit, doesn't it? Many back in the day, especially, think about the calling of the first disciples, were able just to do a complete 180 with their lives. Turn their lives around. Think about Simon Peter, James, and John. They were out on the boat fishing. And Jesus came to them as they were fishing, and he called them to be the disciples, and they left their careers, their jobs, their father, to follow Jesus. Just like that. Even earlier in Mark, we talk about the calling of Levi. In Mark 2, verses 13 to 14, Levi dropped everything. He was a tax collector. Jesus went out again in verse 13. He says, went out again beside the sea, the whole crowd gathered around him, and he taught them. And as he was walking along, he saw Levi, the son of Alphaeus, sitting at the tax booth, and he said to him, follow me. And Levi just got up and followed him. It's hard to do that these days. When I preach, understand I'm preaching to myself too, because it's hard. I'm part-time. I haven't given up my calling of doing my job to be a minister full-time. So I'm preaching to myself a little bit, but it takes one step at a time, followed by another step, followed by a third step, and a fourth step, to where you begin to think and you begin to see that you're not setting your sight on the earthly things, but you're setting your sight on the divine things. It takes work. Step by step, hour by hour, day by day, and year by year. I was reading this morning, I was preparing this morning. Most of you know who Francis Chan is. He's a noted author, speaker, teacher. He spoke at a Christian Resources exhibition back in 2010. Of course, Francis, if you've ever taken some of the Bible studies, I think we did a James Bible study with him. He's a great teacher. But he spoke at this Christian Resources exhibition back in 2010. And he said, radical living was not only for the early church believers, but it's what the church today is also called to. He had experienced resistance to the radical extent of his service of Christ, not only from non-believers, but from his fellow believers as well. He said that all Christians were called to live like the early church believers who denied themselves and took up their crosses, sold their possessions to the poor, and shared everything they had. And he went on to say at this conference, he said, to me, it's crazy to live any other way than a completely radical lifestyle. He said it just wasn't for the apostles. It just wasn't for the early believers. But it's for us today. He lamented that Christians were often missing the point on the level of commitment, the level of passion, and what it takes to be a Christian and to share the gospel. You go to church these days and you stare forward, you sing some songs, you listen to the message, and you go home. Haven't you wondered how come everyone's so content and everyone acts like it's the norm and this is okay when your heart is driving you crazy and it doesn't square with Scripture? And he went on to say, and he closed, he says, I feel very concerned for those people who walk into these buildings we call church and think they're Christians because they say a prayer and they made a decision. Saying a prayer means nothing if you don't take it and follow through and take it to the next step and take it to the next step and the next step and the continued step in your relationship with Christ. Today, we have to take those steps. And they be for baby steps for some of us. And another baby step. But we have to take the steps to live as Christ wanted us to live. And that's in relationship with Him. Our relationship with Him, with our hearts, our minds, our focus, not set on the earthly things, but set on the divine things and the heavenly things. I think Jesus would be thrilled if everybody was able to drop everything they did and follow Him. But we are creatures of habit. And we're in the earthly mode right now. We're working our way. But as long as we're working our way to the divine way, that's what Jesus loves. But we need to keep reminding ourselves each day, whether we're at home, whether we're at work, whether we're at school, wherever we may be, that we need to be working our way towards Jesus and our relationship with Him, to pick up our crosses and follow Him. Pray with me. Father, we give You thanks and we give You praise this morning. Lord, we know that as we are gathered here, we do so by choice. We want to learn Your ways. We want to continue to work step by step in our relationship with You. Father, we seek Your blessings this morning, that as we put one step forward, we know that You're also putting a step forward towards us. Because, Lord, we're the ones making that commitment to You to be faithful, to learn more, to grow our relationship each day. Father, that's what You're calling us to do. To move closer to You. Father, we give You thanks and we give You praise. And it's in Your name we pray, as Your people. Amen. Next part of our service is about giving a little bit back to God in our offering. If you're watching this at home, online, or on Channel 6, there are several different ways you can give to the continuing growth of the church, and that is to mail a check to 420 West Iowa. You can also drop it by the office. We have somebody here Monday through Friday, as well as you can go online to epworth.info and go over to the top right, and you can donate through PushPay. Those are just several of the ways that you can give to your church this morning. as we have our time of offering this morning. If you're here in the sanctuary, we aren't passing the plates, but they are located on the corners of the altar as we have our offering time. Let us rise and declare our faith in Christ through the words of the Apostles' Creed this morning. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
All right, for our song ascending forth, we will be doing Hosanna, Praises Rising. Glory.
As we prepare to go out, one of the things I told Jill this morning is I don't play guitar, so I'm not singing Go in Peace. I leave that to Scott, because he is watching. I just found out he was watching. I'll be in his office tomorrow morning. No. Go now with God's grace and God's peace, knowing that at all times, each hour, each day, each week, each month, each year, He is with us, and He will bless us accordingly. Go now with God's grace and peace. Amen.